at a glance, including in which we have discussed about the dosage forms, the scope of pharmaceutics, why dosage forms have to be formulated, and then there are several dosage forms. Among those, we have discussed about the benefits, applications, formulation, and manufacturing of a few semi-solid dosage form, including ointment and paste. So now let us continue the topic. And thus now the next semi-solid dosage form in continuation to that is creams. So as we have discussed earlier, the ointments are semi-solid dosage forms in which a suitable base is there and a particular drug or a mixture of APIs are incorporated into the bases to form a semi-solid dosage form. So in that, we have also discussed a concept of emulsion. Though you have to study this topic of emulsion in your another module, that is liquid dosage form, that is biphasic liquid dosage form. But here, in just for that getting the introduction, I am just again talking about this emulsion concept. So creams are very dispersed systems that are also known as emulsion, in which an insoluble liquid phase is dispersed within a second liquid phase. For example, in earlier session also, I have discussed you and I have given the example of milk, that is a natural emulsion. Okay, but that natural emulsion, or we can say that any liquid phase when dispersed with a aqueous phase is dispersed with an oily phase, and we add some emulsifying agent into them to emulsify the oily phase into the aqueous phase, we get the product known as emulsion. Now, this emulsion is maybe liquid in its state, or it may exist in the semi-solid state. So that semi-solid state of emulsion is known as cream formulation. Okay, so in common language, in simple language, we can say that the creams are emulsions that offer greater consistency, that is viscosity, and are applied topically. While the liquid emulsions may be used for the oral formulations or many other applications that you will discuss, you will study later on. So pharmaceutical creams are semi-solid preparations containing one or more medicinal agents dissolved or dispersed in either a water in oil type emulsion or oil in water type emulsion or in another type of water washable base. So let me tell you about the water in oil emulsion or oil in water emulsion. It just means that when we are talking about the two phases, like the one phase is, we are saying that one phase is aqueous phase or water phase and another phase is oil phase. So while formulating an emulsion, it is the general process that one phase act as the external continuous phase and another phase act as the dispersed or emulsified phase, which exists in the form of small globules or droplets into the external phase. So water in oil emulsion just tells that if the external phase or continuous phase is oil and the water exists in that phase as a dispersed globules, then that type of emulsion is known as water in oil emulsion. And vice versa, that is, water is the continuous phase and oil exists or oil is present, is dispersed in the form of small globules into the water as an internal phase. Then it would be known as oil in water emulsion. Now, if the oil which we are talking about in this creams formulation, if this particular oil exists in the semi-solid form, at room temperature, then this semi-solid preparation would be known as pharmaceutical creams. Then what are the applications? Major majorly these type of creams are used as protectant or for therapeutic purpose and for cosmetic purposes, maybe for the cosmetic purposes. Generally, in our day-to-day life also, we use a number of creams. Means the cream word is not new for us. Like, we can't say that the cream word we have heard after getting into the touch with this pharmaceutical profession. The cream word we are listening from the our day-to-day life. So, different types of cream includes oil in water cream, as I have just already told you, then water in oil cream, cosmetic creams, and medicated creams. So let us discuss them in very brief and their examples also. Oil in water creams, as I have already told you, in which water will be the continuous phase and oil will be the internal phase. They are composed of small droplets of oil dispersed in an aqueous continuous phase, and they are more comfortable and cosmetically acceptable as they are less greasy, obviously, because oil is the internal phase, the outer phase is water. When we apply this kind of formulation onto the skin or topically, the aqueous layer or the outer layer of that particular formulation will come in the contact of the skin. Thus, it would be less greasy. Moreover, it can be easily washed off using water. It is the very general thing. If the formulation is less greasy, then it could be easily washed off using water. Now, for preparing any emulsion, as we have already discussed, emulsion consists of an oil phase, of aqueous phase. So, but they are immiscible with each other. So, to make them miscible, to make them a stable, homogeneous dispersion formulation, we need to add a certain kind of excipient, which is known as emulsifying agent. Okay. So, various emulsifying agents of natural origin, such as beeswax, wool alcohol, or wool fat, they can be added to make an oil in water cream formulation. These beeswax, wool alcohol, and wool fat, they are not the new words to us. As in the initial session, in earlier session of semi-solid dosage form, in which we have studied about the ointment. So these are the same oleaginous bases which we have studied in the ointment chapter. So, because they are having emulsifying properties, so they can be used as an emulsifying agent for preparing a suitable cream formulation. Now, these formulations are having emollient property. They are creamy in nature, white, or maybe they are translucent and stiff. So, the common example, the marketed formulation which we use as in the category of oil in water cream is vanishing cream. So vanishing cream is a kind of cosmetic cream which is applied onto the skin and is, as its name suggests, vanish. Vanish means being disappeared. So when we apply it, because it is very less greasy, as we have already discussed, after its application, it forms a very thin layer on the skin and it vanishes out. Means we it this cream would be removed off, not removed off, but this cream will not be appeared, and this act as the protectant layer for the skin. Next type of cream is water in oil cream, just opposite to the first one, initial one, that was the oil in water cream. In that, water was the external phase. But in this case, oil is the external phase, while water acts as the internal dispersed phase of the cream. Now, as the name suggests, it is composed of small droplets of water dispersed in a continuous oily phase. Thus, it would be a kind of oily cream. Oily cream in the sense, or we can say that it would be more occlusive than the initial oil in water cream. So, due to its inherent property, it is more difficult to handle. But many drugs which are incorporated into creams are hydrophobic and will be released more readily from a water in oil cream than an oil in water cream. So more moisturizing, as they provide an oily barrier which reduces water loss from the stratum corneum, the outermost layer of that is the outermost layer of the skin. And the common example in this category is cold cream. The cold cream we generally use at our home in our day-to-day life in the season of winters. Because in winter season, the moisture of the skin disappears due to low temperature, and to provide the moisturizing effect to the skin, we apply certain oily creams. So this oily cream is a kind of water in oil cream, that is cold cream. So another classification of these creams means these creams, as we have classified the creams on the basis of the external face, oil in water or water in oil, the another kind of classification can be, they can be classified in the terms of their therapeutic property. So they can be cosmetic creams, means the creams which are having the cosmetic effect on the skin, means they are applied for their moisturizing effect or lubricant effect or just protective effect, but they are not intended to impart any kind of therapeutic response or any kind of pharmacological change in the body. So the various examples, the range of cosmetic creams includes all-purpose cream, baby cream, barrier cream. Barrier cream is generally applied on the facial skin for retaining the makeup for long period of time. Then bleaching cream, cleansing cream to remove the dirt or the toxins or makeup from the skin, it is used. Then cold cream, hair cream, hand cream or vanishing cream. While on the other hand, the cream can be formulated as a medicated creams. So medicated cream will have all the ingredients as per its formulation characteristics, as per its formulation requirements. Along with it, it may have one or more than one active pharmaceutical ingredients. So the property of the active pharmaceutical ingredient will define its activity. Means the cream, if the cream contains any antiseptic agent as an API, then the cream would be known as antiseptic cream. For example, citramide cream, and the citramide is used as an antiseptic. And when we add citramide to any conventional cream, a base cream, it would be known as antiseptic cream. Similarly, zinc oxide, a compound which has astringent activity. So this zinc oxide cream is known as astringent cream. So thus we can say that the creams can be classified as cosmetic creams or medicated creams. Now moving further, the formulation of creams. Next topic is formulation of creams after its classification. So formulation of creams means the formula or the excipient or the manufacturing variables which are involved in the formulation of a cream. So as we have already discussed, all the semi-solid dosage forms are based on certain bases. So for formulation of a cream, there are various bases, like some oily base, then aqueous agent would be there, because these creams are the combination of oily face and aqueous face. Now, to make a stable cream formulation, stable emulsion formulation, and to give the miscibility to the aqueous and oily contents of the cream, we require a agent known as emulsifying agent. Okay, so creams may be formulated from variety of oils such as mineral and vegetable oils, from fatty alcohols, fatty acids and fatty esters, as we have discussed the examples in earlier slides also. The solid excipients are melted at the time of preparation, and emulsifying agents include non-ionic surfactants, detergents, and soaps. Now, there is a basic formulation method for preparation of cream, and that is on the as similar to the fusion method which we have discussed in the formulation of ointment or paste. Okay, so in this method there are two phases, like oil phase and aqueous phase. So we have to formulate in the preparation of cream. The general procedure is preparation of the two phases separately, okay, and then heating the two phases at the same temperature according to their melting points, and then adding the aqueous phase into the oily phase while a continuous stirring, and the stirring would be done till the emulsification process completes, and then they are allowed, the mixture or the emulsified homogeneous mass is allowed to get cooled slowly, not rapidly, and then we will get the final emulsion formulation or cream formulation. So in detail, if we discuss point wise, so preparation, first is the preparation of oil phase, which includes flake powder ingredients, sometimes dry, blended in advance, are dispersed into mineral oil or silicone oil. Heating may be required to melt some ingredients if required. Then a second step is hydration of aqueous phase ingredients like emulsifiers, thickeners, stabilizers. They are dispersed into water in a separate vessel to make an aqueous phase. Then heating may be required to accelerate their hydration or dissolution. The two phases are blended under various agitation, by manual agitation or by mechanical using some electronic machines to form the emulsion. Then the active ingredient often makes up only a small proportion of the formulation. So this must be efficiently dispersed to maximize yield and product effectiveness. In means, we can say that the active ingredient, according to its miscibility, it may be added into the oily phase or it may be added into the aqueous phase, and then a homogeneous mixture is allowed to form, so that the homogeneous product means the product would contain the active ingredient in an homogenized manner. So after discussing this cream formulation, let us move to the last, or we can say fourth, semi-solid formulation for the intended for the external application, and that is gels. So gels, sometimes also called as jellies, they are semi-solid systems consisting of dispersion of small or large molecules in an aqueous liquid vehicle rendered jelly-like by the addition of a gelling agent. Okay, gelling agent, name as name uska suggest kar raha hai, that by for making a gel formulation we have to add some agent which is responsible for formulating the gel. So the major polymer or the major ingredient which is commonly used to form a gel is can be natural polymers or synthetic polymers such as carbomer, like carbopol, and cellulose polymers such as HPMC, hydroxypropyl methyl cellulose, or hydroxypropyl cellulose. Another natural gums like tragaganth, pectin, agar, natural gums are used in the formulation of gels. So let me give an day-to-day common example of this gel, which there is a product known as gond katira, gond, jisko we also known as gums in Hindi, or in our regional language we say gum as the gond. So from a particular plant we get a resin, that is gond katira. generally North India, it is very much consumed. So if we put that particular gond or gum in water and allow it to hydrate for around 6 to 8 hours, that particular gum or gond absorb the water, get swelled and convert into a gel-like spongy material. So similarly, these all are the natural or semi-synthetic or synthetic polymers which are used to formulate gels, and they are used in topical applications for various pharmaceutical applications. So as per the National Formulary, NF, 6 polymers are used for gel formulation. They are different grades of carbomers or carbopol, that is 910, 934, 934P, 940, 941 and etc. So these carbomers 940, among all the carbomer 940 produce highest viscosity of gel of having highest viscosity, whose viscosity is ranging between 40,000 to 60,000 centipoise in a 0.5% aqueous solution. Aqueous solution means if we are formulating an aqueous solution of concentration 0.5% carbopol, so the gel which we will be getting will be having a viscosity of ranging between 40,000 to 60,000 centipoise. Now, these gels can be classified in various manners, like based on their use. The gels can be classified on the basis of their use. So, the various gels are medicated gels, lubricating gels, or they may be miscellaneous purpose, yeah, all-purpose gels. On the basis of their nature of colloidal system, they can be classified as single phase system, that is organic gels, or two phase systems, that is inorganic gels. And on the basis of the nature of the solvent which is used in the formulation of those gel formulations, they may be classified as hydrogels, organogels, or zero gels. So now let us discuss these different types of gels one by one. So first one is medicated gels. So they are used on mucous membrane or skin. Their actions include lubrication, antiseptic, vasoconstrictor or contraceptive. The mechanism of these formation of these medicated gels, like they evaporation of water, which produces a cooling sensation to the skin, and the jelly content remains thick as film to the applied area and gives protection to the skin. So a number of marketed formulation examples exist, like ephedrine sulfate gel or jelly. It acts as the vasoconstrictor. Phenyl mercuric nitrate gel, it acts as the contraceptive, as it has this spermicidal activity, and they can be applied topically into the body cavities. Second category is lubricating gels. Lubricating gels has a property that it is thin, transparent, and water soluble. It must be sterile when inserted into sterile regions of the body, and it is used for lubrication in various medical devices like rectal thermometers, urinary bladders, finger stalls, cytoscopes, surgical gloves, or catheters. These lubricating gels are just used for the lubricating property, but they should not impart any kind of their therapeutic activity. Now, third is the miscellaneous gels, which are used in some diagnostic evaluations or some other purposes. For example, patch testing, used for vehicle used as vehicle for allergens applied on skin in allergy test when we go for a allergy testing. So patch testing method is used. Then electrocardiography, ECG or EEG, or some MRIs or CT scans in which the some electrodes has to be applied onto the skin from which certain electrical conductions are created, and they diagnose a particular diseases. So these jellies contain sodium chloride, which act as an electrolyte, or maybe pumice powder or glycerin. So they reduce electrical resistance between skin and electrode and thus help in the such kind of diagnostic tests. So this was the classification of gels on the basis of their use or application. Now let us move on another classification of gels, that is on the basis of the solvent present in those gels, and they are mainly of three types, as I have told you in the classification: hydrogels, organogels and xerogels. So first let us discuss about the hydrogels. So a hydrogel is a network of polymer chains that are hydrophilic, sometimes found as a colloidal gel in which water is the dispersion medium. Hydrogels are highly absorbent and they can contain over 90% of the water. They may be natural or synthetic polymer networks. Hydrogels also possess a degree of flexibility very similar to natural tissues due to their significant water content. The common ingredients include polyvinyl alcohol, sodium polyacrylate, acrylate, other acrylate polymers, carbomers, etc. And they are basically used as an environment sensitivity detector for sustained formulating the sustained release drug delivery system. Sustained release drug delivery system means a drug delivery system, a dosage form in which the drug has been incorporated, and from that dosage form the drug is being released at a very slow speed or at a sustained manner. These hydrogels are also used in the contact lenses, formulation of contact lenses, ECG medical electrodes, and as a glue material in many orthopedic purposes. Second one is the xerogels, open network formed by removal of all swelling agents from a gel. And xerogels have a property of having to retaining a high porosity of approximately 15 to 50% of their actual weight, and enormous surface area because they are having high porosity. So they create an enormous surface area along with very small pore size of approximately 1 to 10 nanometers. When solvent removal occurs under supercritical conditions means at very high temperature or very low pressure conditions, the evaporation of the solvent occurs. The solvent gets evaporated, but the network does not shrink, and a highly porous, low density material known as aerogel is produced, and it is the similar to the xerogel. Last is the organogels. Now an organogel is a non-crystalline, non-glassy, thermoreversible, or we can say that thermoplastic solid material composed of a liquid organic phase. So that is the difference between organogels and hydrogels. Hydrogels consist of the hydrous phase, or we can say that hydrophilic solvent, while organogels consist of the organic solvent as a phase, and in which the materials get entrapped in a three-dimensional cross-linked network. The liquid can be, for example, an organic solvent, mineral oil or vegetable oil. So these systems are based on self-assembly of the structuring molecules. Now, after discussing the basic formulation and various classification of gels, now move towards the method of formulation of the gels. So basically, there are three methods for formulating the gel or jelly semi-solid formulation. So it includes fusion method, cold method, and dispersion method. So now let us discuss these methods in detail one by one. So first is the fusion method. The fusion method, as I have already discussed in the ointment as well as in paste or as well as in cream formulation, the fusion method is the basic phenomena or the basic concept behind the fusion method is same. In this method, various waxy materials, they are employed as a gelling agent or gelant in non-polar medium. Then drug was added when waxy materials are melted by fusion. Means like in ointment also, we have discussed the fusion method in which the hydrocarbon bases or some other suitable bases are melted, into which the drugs are being dispersed or suspended, and they are homogeneously mixed, and then they are allowed to cool again to get a semi-solid ointment. Similarly, in this also, the waxy materials which act as the gelling agent also, because now we are discussing gels. So gelling agent will be of waxy nature. They will be dispersed or dissolved or mixed with some non-polar, means some organic solvents, and the drug is then added into that melted mixture of waxy materials, and they are stirred slowly until a uniform gel is formed and cooled and get cooled slowly, not rapidly. These are the precautions which we have already discussed in previous methods also, that rapid cooling may result in the precipitation or the instability of the developed formulation. So moving towards the next method is the cold method. In this method, water was cooled to 4 to 10 degrees Celsius and it is placed in a mixing container because it is a cold method. Then gelling agent is slowly added and agitated until solution is complete. Solution is complete means we can say that till the gelling agent get completely dissolved in the cool water. The temperature should be maintained below 10 degrees Celsius, and then the drug can be added in the solution form slowly with gentle mixing, and then it should be transferred to the container and allowed to warm to the room temperature, whereupon a liquid becomes clear gel. So it is a kind of sole to gel transformation for the formation of a clear gel formulation using cold method. Third method includes the dispersion method, in which gelling agent is generally dispersed in water with stirring at a high speed like 12,000 RPM for a particular period of time varying as per the specification required, for example, 20 to 30 minutes or till an hour. So in this, drug can be dissolved in non-aqueous solvent also, which contains some other excipients such as preservatives as per the requirement of the formulation. And this solution can be added in the above gel with continuous stirring. Means the drug solution, if drug is hydrophobic in nature, it can be dissolved in some known aqueous solvent and it can be added. It will be added to the gelling agent dispersion and we get the gel. So the very common example, the polymer which is used, which is prepared on the basis of this dispersion method, is carbopol gel. In this, any drug dispersion, the gelling agent can be added, that is carbopol, by dispersion method and stirred. It is stirred till 12,000 at 12,000 RPM for 30 minutes. And because the gelling property of the carbopole is pH dependent, then the pH of the formulation is converted into, is shifted towards the alkaline nature by adding some alkalinizing agent like triethanolamine. Upon addition of the triethanolamine, TEA, the pH of the dispersion shifts towards the alkaline, and the sole formulations, the sole dispersion of the carbopole converts into a gel formulation. So with this, we have completed all our four semi-solid dosage forms as prescribed in our syllabus, including ointment, paste, cream, and gel. So let us now give a glance, revision of these four formulations having different excipients. So like we have discussed ointment, it contains an single API or a mixture of API. It also contains the major ingredient, that is ointment base. Along with it, it may contain certain other excipients as on the basis of their requirement, like preservatives to prevent the microbial contamination, antioxidants to prevent the oxidation of drug as well as the components which are used as base, chelating agent to avoid the chelating, humectant, and the perfume if required. The paste, on the other hand, is also similar to the ointment, but it is more stiffer than the ointment as it generally contains a high solid content, for example, more than 20 or 25%. So all the formulation procedures are similar in the ointment and paste, but the major difference is it contains a higher solid content. On the other hand, another semi-solid dosage form which we have discussed is cream formulation. The cream formulation contains the aqueous phase, the oily phase, and a important component is emulsifying agent. So emulgents, co-emulsifier, emulsion stabilizer, or maybe mixed emulsifier systems are the essential components of this cream formulation. It may also contain humectants, stabilizers, or perfumes as per the requirement. The last semi-solid dosage form which we have discussed is gel, and the major composition in the gel is gelling agent along with the single or multiple APIs. If we are talking about the medicated gelling agent, then it may contain preservative, chelating agents, or some hygroscopic substances. So in this slide, I am just showing you the different marketed formulations of marketed semi-solid formulations. For example, in the case of ointment, lidocaine ointment, sulfur ointment for acne medication, then bupanthan ointment, which is an keratolytic, fusidin ointment, which is used as a topical antibiotic. So these are the few images of the commercial marketed ointments available. Similarly, these are various examples of paste. Generally, as we have discussed in the earlier session also, the paste is quite thicker and stiffer than the ointment, and due to its higher stiffness, rarely they are used in the body places where there is a growth of hairs. So generally the paste are used in the some oral or dental diseases. Most common example is toothpaste. We all use toothpaste in our day-to-day life. So here are a few images of the toothpaste like Colgate. Then skin barrier paste is there. Some medicated paste like Absol oral paste. It contains Amlixonox as an API. Then Kinocart, that is triamnisolone acetonide oral paste. Then some other dental pastes are available for the oral lesions or wounds. Then these are the few examples of cream, medicated as well as non-medicated creams. Non-medicated cream like cold cream available in the market of various brands like Pond's, Lakme, many other medicated creams includes the therapeutic agent into it. And the various examples are Nizoral cream, that is the antifungal cream having the main API as ketoconazole. Zovirex cream, 5%, it comes in the strength of 5%, and the main API present in this cream is acyclovir, antiviral. Then clotrimazole cream, very much commonly used in market, sale in market. It is an antifungal cream. Then retinone, that is triretinone cream used in the psoriasis or other skin dermatological conditions. Similarly, hydrocortisone cream. Then next is the gels. These are the few examples of the gels. The gels, one, the use of gel is used in some dental applications, like instead of paste, there are dental gels are available in the market. They are for the cosmetic purpose, but some medicated gels are also available, like Metro gel. It is a gel of metronidazole. Then hydroxyquinone, that is a skin bleaching gel with sunscreens. Then Volatarin osteogel, this is used for the orthopedic purposes. Then Iodent gel, that is maximum strength oral analgesic gel having benzocaine as its important active ingredient. Now, I have already discussed with you the differences between ointment, paste, cream and gel. Why I am emphasizing on this differences in a much extent? Because as per our syllabus, we are discussing all these semi-solid dosage forms, and this is a kind of very important question for the at the examination point of view. So difference between ointment, paste, cream and gel, we have already discussed. Moving forward, now evaluation of semi-solid dosage forms. As we have discussed four semi-solid dosage forms, so now we will discuss their evaluation one by one. So let us start evaluation of ointment and creams. So there are many important physicochemical characteristics and evaluations of the dosage form. Here we will be discussing a few of them, including drug content, release rate of medicament from base, penetration rate of medicament, absorption of medicament into bloodstream, consistency of the preparation, and its irritant or any effect on the skin. So first is the drug content. According to this, the test which is done for evaluating the drug content is minimum field test as prescribed by the pharmacopeial standards. So this test includes the selection of randomly sampling of 10 filled containers, and those containers are weighed for the required amount of the ointment. Medicament is then extracted in a suitable solvent, and then drug content can be determined by any suitable analytical technique, and the results should be as per the specification of the labeled quantity. Means, like if the gel or if the cream or ointment, the label claims that it is a cream or ointment having 5% of the active ingredient, so with according to the specification, in a limit range, the result should be indicating its drug content. This drug content is very much important for the efficacy part of the formulation. Now, next important evaluation test is the release rate of medicament from base. Now, what this means, we have formulated a medicated ointment or cream having a base into which a drug is solubilized or dispersed or emulsified. Now, after application of the dosage form onto the skin, the drug should release from that medicament and act on the target site and produce its therapeutic intended response. If the release rate of medicament is not proper, it would compromise its efficacy of the formulation. So here we are going to discuss two major in vitro techniques for the determination of release rate. First is the agar cup plate method, and second is the diffusion method. So first, agar cup plate method, it is generally done to determine the release rate of antibacterial ointments or semi-solid dosage forms. In this, the common procedure is we take some agar plates. Agar plates act as a nutrient growth. Your nutrient media consist of several required components for the growth of microorganisms. Then, with the help of small cylindrical vessels, holes are created, as you are able to see in the PPT, in the slides. Some holes are created into the agar, solidified agar plates, and this agar medium is then seeded with some microorganism like Staphylococcus aureus, and then the formulation can be applied onto the that gel, that is the agar plate, and the zone of inhibition of bacterial growth is measured around the circular cups. As you see in the slide, there are two examples has been shown. In first, this is colony of the microbes developed in agar growth. The dots indicating the colonies of microbes developed in the agar growth. While in the second Petri plate, where the antibiotic formulation, antibiotic semi-solid ointment has also been added into the agar plate, which has been seeded with Staphylococcus aureus, a zone of inhibition has been created. And that particular zone of inhibition of bacterial growth can be measured in terms of drug release. So, if higher the zone of inhibition, it will indicate the higher release of the medicament from that particular ointment. Similarly, another method which can be used for determination of the release rate includes diffusion method. Now, already in our initial lecture, I have told you about the process of diffusion. So, again, I'm just telling you the diffusion process. Diffusion means the absorption. We can say that absorption, or we can say that in the case of topical formulation, we can say that penetration or permeation means the movement of drug through a semi-permeable membrane, and the drug moves from a region of high concentration to a region of low concentration, means according to its concentration gradient, the drug moves through a semi-permeable membrane. So now, for the evaluation of ointment, medicated ointments, the kind of parchment membrane which act as a semi-permeable membrane is used, and it can be tied at the end of a glass tube, means like the glass tubes, test tubes which we use, they can be open from the both ends. At the one end, we can tie the parchment membrane, semi-permeable membrane, and that glass tube can be filled with the formulation. The ointment should be filled in the tube properly and spread on the membrane. Then that filled tube is dipped in the dissolution or release medium. Maybe it can be distilled water or any prescribed dissolution medium, which has to be maintained at 37 plus minus 0.5 degrees Celsius. After dipping that particular test tube into the release or dissolution media, the samples from that dissolution media can be withdrawn after a specified period of time, and the samples are analyzed for the drug content using some particular analytical method. Means there are a number of analytical methods are available, like spectrophotometric method or chromatographic method, that you will be studying in your analysis subject. So we can find the drug content that has been released per unit time from the formulation. And means like we have taken the sample at 15 minutes, then after 30 minutes, then 45 minutes, 1 hour, and so on. And we will get a cumulative drug release from the formulation at different time intervals. And then a graph can be plotted between drug concentration and time. So this will give us an idea, evaluation of how the drug is being diffusing out from the semi-solid ointment or semi-solid dosage form. So in the slide, this is an example, diagrammatic representation of the glass tube having parchment membrane, or maybe we can use some human skin or some animal skin in onto which the formulation can be applied, and that is dipped into the dissolution medium. This is an apparatus designed to determine release rate of drug from the base by diffusion method, and on getting the analytical values of drug concentration at different time intervals, this kind of graph can be plotted. So this graph will be known as drug release profile or drug release pattern of the drug releasing from the base. Next evaluation test is penetration rate of medicament. So penetration rate of medicament means that at what rate the drug is being penetrating into the skin. So for this, rubbing and weighing method is generally used. In this, weighed quantity or amount of the formulation is applied on the skin or at the topical site, rubbed into a defined area for a particular size of area, like 1 cm² or 2 cm² for a fixed particular time. Then unabsorbed material is removed completely and weighed, and difference in weight provides the total base penetrated. Accordingly, the rate can be calculated. The penetration rate can be calculated. So similarly, this was the method for evaluating the topical formulations on which we want to estimate the penetration. Now some ointments like diadermic ointment, which we have discussed, so it is intended for the transdermal application, transdermal or systemic effect. So to analyze its intended application, that whether the drug from the diadermic ointment is reaching into the systemic circulation in the bloodstream or not, we have to evaluate the absorption of medicament into bloodstream. So for this, certain in vivo methods can be employed. Now here a term came, in vivo. So in vivo means into the test which has to be done in the living organisms, like in animals or on the humans. So the test which we have discussed earlier, a kind of in vitro method. In vitro means outside the body, or we can say that in the laboratory conditions, like the diffusion method, the dialysis membrane or parchment membrane tied on the glass tube is a kind of in vitro method, where we have created the conditions of the body outside the body. Means the conditions which are present in the body are created outside the body, and the temperature and other things are simulated accordingly. So in that method, if the formulation is diffusing out in vitro, then might be it is possible that it will perform accordingly in the in vivo. But if we want to study the absorption parameter of the medicament into bloodstream, we have to go with an in vivo method. So for this, certain animals are selected, animal models can be selected, and onto them the formulation can be applied, the ointment or cream formulation under investigation that can be applied. After the application of the formulation, as per its default property intended use, it will get absorbed into the systemic circulation by crossing the biological membranes. The process would be known as transcutaneous permeation. And the levels of drug that reached into the systemic circulation can be evaluated by taking the blood samples at particular period of time. Blood samples or urine or any feces samples can also be used, but the most preferred method is the collecting blood samples at different intervals of time. Those blood samples can be assayed for the drug content. Assayed for the drug content means the amount of drug present in the blood samples can be analyzed using some analytical method like spectrophotometric method or HPLC like chromatographic method. And similar to the previous method, we can get a data of time versus percent drug absorbed. So accordingly, we can get the idea of the absorption of medicament into the tissue. Now, next is the consistency of the preparation. This can be evaluated by determined by sliding a glass plate over the product by means of a pulley. Product should spread evenly on the another glass plate fixed on a wooden block. Weights can be added to the pan so that sliding of the movable glass plate is obtained. And the weight which is required to move the ointment, and that can be a indicator of the consistency of the formulation. Means higher, if the formulation is stiffer, it would having less spreadability, and more weight is required to spread that particular formulation. So this is a kind of apparatus for determining consistency of the ointment. Then last evaluation, common evaluation, is its irritant effect. Irritant effect means, as in the previous discussions we have discussed, that the formulation, any semi-solid dosage formulation, should be inert in nature. Inert, or we can say that compatible with the skin. So compatibility or inertness indicates that it should having no irritation or no sensitization effect. So the most important aspect of its safety concern, if we are talking, dekho, we are discussing about the formulation evaluation. So as we have already discussed, there should be three essential characteristics in any formulation: quality, safety and efficacy. So like quality, we are discussing the formulation should remain stable. The efficacy, we are discussing like the permeation, if the formulation is getting permeated into the skin or not. That particular evaluation test is for the evaluation of the efficacy. Now for the safety, safety means it should not has any kind of toxicity or irritant effect, because we are applying the formulation on the skin. If it may have some allergic reactions with the skin, it may create some edema, inflammation, redness. So this can be evaluated by a test commonly known as Dray's test. So the test is performed on the skin if it has to be applied on the skin, or eyes of rabbit or human skin if it is for the ocular ophthalmic purpose. It can also be injected into the thigh muscle and under abdominal skin in rats if we are evaluating the transdermal formulation. So they, after application of the formulation, the animals or the humans which are acting as the volunteers in the study, they are observed daily for a week or as per the specifications, and any signs or symptoms of lesions, redness, edema, inflammation, they can be evaluated accordingly to the Dray's test, and some scores can be given. And if there are no signs of irritation or edema, then the formulation would be accepted as a known irritant formulation. Otherwise, it would be concluded that it has some irritation effect. So next is the evaluation of gels, which include the physicochemical properties of the formulations, like rheological properties, determination of yield value, spreadability, stability, and safety evaluations. So let us complete this topic in hurry. So rheological property means the flow properties of the formulation, like their viscosity and their movement. So generally, the gels, in particular, if we talk about the gels, this is the most important evaluation for the rheological, for the gel formulations, because as we have discussed that in formulation of gels, there is a sol to gel or gel to sol transformation. Okay. And this kind of transformation is known as non-Newtonian rheological behavior and thixotrophy. Thixotrophy means by applying the shear or stress, the viscosity of the formulation may get increase or decrease. Okay. And for evaluating these rheological properties, generally the indicator is viscosity. And the viscosity can be measured by different kinds of instruments. Generally, in pharmaceutical applications, the semi-solid dosage form Brookfield viscometer is employed for determination of rheology or viscosity of the gels or semi-solid dosage forms. Then the spreadability is another important aspect of the gels. So the spreadability indicates the quality of the formulation. Stability is also one of the important requirements. The formulation should remain stable at various temperatures, because it would come in contact with wide range of temperature during shipping, during transportation, during storage. So the formulation should remain stable at various temperatures. For that, the formulations can be stored at different temperature conditions, like room temperature, the high temperature conditions, or the refrigerated conditions, and they are evaluated for certain physicochemical properties like viscosity, spreadability, drug release. So all these required properties should not be affected due to the variation in the temperature, or else we can determine the required storage conditions. Means if we will able to get that this particular formulation gets more viscous or less viscous, means its viscosity varies at high temperature or very low temperature, then the recommended storage conditions can be evaluated for that particular product. Similarly, safety evaluations as per the compendial requirements is another important aspect. So this includes this. With this, we conclude the all the semi-solid dosage form, in which we have discussed the applications of different semi-solid dosage forms, including ointment, paste, creams, and gels, and their formulation, ingredients, method of preparations, and evaluations. And also we have discussed a few marketed products which are available. Now moving towards the next topic, that is suppositories. Now these suppositories may come in the category of solid dosage form as well as semi-solid dosage form, because they are in between of that. The major difference between the suppositories and other semi-solid dosage forms are the semi-solid dosage forms are come available in the bulk container, like जैसे अगर इफ वी टॉक अबाउट द क्रीम्स फॉर्मुलेशन, दे आर अवेलेबल इन फ्लेक्सिबल ट्यूब्स और द जार्स और कंटेनर्स, प्लास्टिक कंटेनर्स. सो दे आर अवेलेबल इन द बल्क क्वांटिटी, एंड द सपोजिटरी ऑन द अदर हैंड, दे आर अवेलेबल एज अ यूनिट डोजेज फॉर्म. मीन्स द सिंगल सपोजिटरी एज अ सिंगल यूनिट डोजेज फॉर्म कैन बी अवेलेबल, एंड दे आर यूज्ड इन अ different manner. So let us now start discussing the basics of the suppositories. A suppository is a solid dosage form in which one or more APIs, that is active pharmaceutical ingredients, are dispersed in a suitable base and molded or otherwise formed into a suitable shape for insertion into the body cavities such as rectum, where they melt, soften, or get dissolved and exert local or systemic effect. Means just you assume that a suppository is a kind of solid dosage form, as you have all have seen some tablet dosage form or capsule dosage form, but they are hard. Means their touch, they are found to be some hard or viscous. But these suppositories are soft in nature. Thus, we can say that they are a kind of not similar to the solid dosage form, not similar to the semi-solid dosage form. They are somewhere in between of them, because when we insert them into the body cavities at the body temperature, they are required to get melted or softened, and then they convert into the semi-solid consistency. And then they exert some local or systemic effects. So now no need to explain this local or systemic effect in detail. Just you can get that local effect means if the formulation which we have, the suppository which we have applied topically, it produces the therapeutic response or effect at the target site where it has been applied. Maybe it has some lubricating effect or some other therapeutic effect, then that is for the local use. But if the medicament which is present in that suppository get absorbed through the mucosal sites, then it reaches into the systemic route, means into the blood. The drug will reach into the blood and it will elicit a therapeutic or pharmacological response. So administration of drugs in the body cavities may be performed to treat local disorders like infection, inflammation, or to achieve systemic absorption of the therapeutic agent in situations where alternative routes of drug administrations are inappropriate. Okay, like alternative routes like parenteral route or oral route, by which are the other mechanisms by which the drug get absorbed and get into the systemic route, systemic circulation. So suppositories are the main class of rectal dosage forms. Means we can give them some other name, that is rectal dosage forms. However, in the rectal dosage forms, not only suppositories are used, but other semi-solid formulations like creams, gels, and foams can also be used for the purpose. Now, there is another name, that is pessaries. So, suppositories and pessaries, they both are the semi-solid or solid dosage forms that are inserted into the rectum and vaginal cavity respectively. For the rectum, it is known as suppositories, while for the vaginal cavity, it is known as pessaries. And these both dosage forms are known sterile formulations. But if we will be talking about icones, some suppositories which are for the ocular purpose, they should be sterile in nature. Now, let us discuss a brief history of the suppositories. So, the derivation of the word suppository is from the Latin word supponere. Supponere meaning to place under. The meaning of supponere, Latin term, is to place under, as derived from sub. Sub word means under, and ponere. Sub ponere consists of two words. Sub means under, and ponere means to place. So the word means to place under. So they are meant both linguistically and therapeutically to be placed into the body cavities, as in the rectum or other organs. Rectal administration, though it is not often the first route of choice, but it becomes a good alternative when the oral routes is or other routes are not advisable or they are not applicable. Relatively low cost and lack of technical difficulties make rectal drug administration attractive when compared to parenteral therapy. If we are talking about the systemic use of these suppositories or systemic application of these kind of pessaries, from where the drug is getting absorbed into the systemic circulation. So we can compare it with the parenteral dosage form, where in parenteral there some technical assistance is required, but in this case no technical assistance is required, as one patient can consume it, can administer it himself or herself. Now there are a few advantages of suppositories, like it avoid first pass effect. Now this first pass effect is, first pass effect means first pass metabolism. So for this I just elaborate it in a line, like when we administer any drug via oral route. Oral route means by swallowing. We swallow a tablet or any liquid dosage form, the formulation reaches into the our GIT, that is gastrointestinal tract, from where the drug get absorbed into the systemic circulation. But in some cases, instead of transferring the drug into the systemic circulation, it first passes to the liver, means from the GIT, from the hepatic portal vein, the drug first go into the metabolizing organ, that is liver. In that, some extent of drug get metabolized, and its bioavailability. Bioavailability means the amount of drug that is reaching into the systemic circulation gets declined. But if we are administering the drug via this in a suppository manner, there is avoidance of this first pass metabolism or first pass effect. Then it melts at the body temperature. The inherent properties, the bases, the excipients, which we will be discussing in next slides, that they are made up of certain kind of material, excipients, which has a nature that they melt at the body temperature. So though at the room temperature they will exist as the solid dosage form, but after administering, they will get melted at the body temperature, and then they will produce their intended effect. It can give both localized as well as systemic action, systemic response. Then it can be given to unconscious patient. If we compare it with some oral formulation, the unconscious patient is not able to swallow the formulation like tablet or capsule. So in those cases, the formulation can be administered to the unconscious patient, and the intended systemic effect can be achieved. It is easy to use for the pediatric and geriatric patients. Similar to previous point, geriatric patients, pediatric patients who have some problems in swallowing the formulations, they may be given this suppositories formulations. They are useful for rapid and direct effect in rectum. There are some local effects of these suppositories, include they are useful to promote evacuation of bowel, as they are used in some kind of as in the treatment of constipation. Then convenient for those drugs which causes GIT irritation or which promote the vomiting, that they can sensitize the CTZ receptor. So if the drug is causing GIT irritation, they may be given by the rectal route in the form of suppository. But as it has certain advantages, it is also associated with as much disadvantages also. For example, the absorption of therapeutic agent from the rectum is slow and prone to large intra-subject and inter-subject variability. Means there is a large variation between the therapeutic response initiated by the formulation, and it varies from person to person, or even in the same person the effect may get vary at different times. Means some day the therapeutic response will be higher and some other day the therapeutic response can be less. Means this variability is due to the varied absorption pattern of the drug from the rectum. Then other physiological conditions like presence of feces within the rectum considerably affect both the rate and extent of drug absorption. Rectal administration of therapeutic agent may result in the development of local side effects. Like some person feel inconvenience or may feel some kind of problem upon rectal administration of these drugs. The industrial manufacturing of suppositories is more difficult than other common dosage form like tablets or capsules. Irritant drugs cannot be administered, as we have discussed that some drugs are irritant in the GIT. So they may also cause irritation in the rectum also. Thus, irritant drug cannot be administered. Then other some psychological problems like embarrassment to the patients or inconvenience in sitting or in other day-to-day work are some other disadvantages associated with suppositories. Moreover, another important aspect related to its stability, where in advantages we are saying that it has an advantage that it melts at the body temperature. But in some countries or some places where the normal temperature is also nearby the normal body temperature, there the stability issue of the formulation may arise. So there is a need to store at a low temperature, which ultimately result in the increase in the cost due to maintenance of cold chain while traveling, while transportation, and while storage of the formulation. Now, next topic, according to the syllabus only, that is the types of suppositories. So basically, they are classified in five types: rectal suppositories that we are discussing, vaginal suppositories that are known as pessaries, urethral suppositories, nasal suppositories, or ear cones. So let us discuss them in very brief. Rectal suppositories, as the name indicating, they are intended to be insertion into the rectal cavity. The weight of the suppository can be varied from the as per the requirement. Like in children, it may from 1 gram, and in adult, the weight can be go beyond the 2 grams. It may also be available in different shapes for the easiness for their administration. Like shape of suppository used in rectal is torpedo shape. The length is about 3 centimeter. Urethral suppositories that are meant to be inserted in the urethra. The weight of this suppository is about 2 gram and ranges in length from 60 to 75 mm long, and they are particularly for the use in females. They are available in different shapes also. Then vaginal suppositories, they are oviform shape, weigh around 3 to 5 gram. They are known as pessaries. It contains the drug which are used in the treatment of various diseases related to females, like female genitourinary tract infections, and also for the meant for contraception. It is contains the combination of certain kind of lipophilic and hydrophilic polymers as a suppository basis, which we will be discussing in next slides. Nasal suppositories are meant for introduction into nasal cavity. The maximum weight can be 1 gram, and the base which are generally used for nasal suppository should be hydrophilic in nature to avoid any kind of infection to the lungs. Ear cones or ear suppositories, they are also known as orinaries, A-U-R, orinaries. These are meant for introduction into the ear for certain kind of ear-related disorders, and generally cylindrical in shape. Cylindrical ear cones are preferred, and the maximum weight can be 1 gram. So here I am showing you different shapes of suppositories like round oval, long oval, teardrop, bullet, tampons, etc., which are available in the market for different routes. Now, next, after discussing the basics of suppositories, their history, their classifications, now we are coming to the formulation of suppositories. So, formulation of suppositories includes the drug and the additives. As I have told you, in any dosage form, there are two major important requirements. One is the API. They may be a single or multiple APIs can be there. And some additives are there which are required to formulate that particular dosage form according to its nature. So in suppositories, the major additives are, the most important is suppositories base. Apart from it, some kind of surfactants, preservatives, antioxidants, buffers, lubricants can also be added. Now let us discuss the about the features of the suppositories base, which is the major excipient to be used in a suppository. So first, the ideal properties of the suppositories base. So there should be some properties which are imparted by the suppositories base, like it must retain the shape and size. The base should be such that it should retain its shape at the normal storage conditions, and it should not create any kind of instability. But at the body temperature, it should get melted to produce its intended therapeutic or any other response. Another important requirement is it should be non-irritant and biocompatible. Non-irritant, as we already discussed, any solid dosage form, if it is creating any kind of irritation, some kind of heating effect, so it would be creating some kind of patient incompliance. So to achieve the patient compliance, it should be non-irritant. Then it should shrink sufficiently to remove from the mold. The mold is the method which the mold is useful or required for preparation of the suppositories that we will be discussing in next slides. So it should have the sufficient property to remove from the mold. It should not interfere in release or absorption of the drug. Means the ideal base should be inert, as I have already told. It should inert in nature. It just have the it should have the property to act as the carrier for the medicament, but itself it should not produce any kind of therapeutic response, as well as it should not interfere or it should not retard the release or absorption of the drug from the dosage form such as suppository. Then it should promote incorporation of the drug, means it should have the sufficient property that the drug should be incorporated into that base to form a stable formulation. Then it should be compatible with variety of drugs. Now this compatible word we have already discussed in morning lecture, and in the my next session we will be discussing this compatibility or incompatibility topic in detail, because there might be some kind of interaction between drug or excipients which we are using. So the major excipient here is the base, and if the base and drugs are not compatible with each other, means upon mixing of drug into the base, suppository base, if they are creating some kind of physicochemical instability or other kind of stable instability, so this would be a kind of incompatibility. So at this point, just understand, just make clear that all the excipients, whether it is suppository base or any other excipient, it should be compatible with the API. Okay. Then another important ideal property of suppository base is it should be physically stable on storage. Means if the base is stable, then we can assume that it will impart stability to the formulation also. Moreover, its hardness should not be varied on storage. So like in evaluation of semi-solid dosage form, we have discussed the stability studies. The formulation should not be get softened or hardened, get hardened on storage, but it should remain as per its specification, as per its quality characteristics, and upon administration, it would be melted. Now, what different kinds of materials can be used as suppository bases? So, the first important, the classification of the suppository bases, it can be classified into majorly three types. The first kind of base is oleaginous bases. Second is hydrophilic or aqueous bases, and third is emulsifying or synthetic fat bases. So as already we have discussed the oleaginous bases in ointments also. So similar to that, hair in suppositories also some oleaginous. Oleaginous means oily in nature. The bases are available which can be used to formulate suppositories, and it includes cocoa butter, emulsified cocoa butter, hydrogenated oils. While in hydrophilic or aqueous bases, this name indicates that the bases would be hydrophilic or aqueous in nature. So the examples are glycerogelatin base, soap, glycerin base, polyethylene glycol, and macrobol bases. While in emulsifying, different kinds of bases are vitepsol, mesa, astaxanthin, and mesifol. So one by one, we will discuss these oleaginous bases. So like first, the most commonly used oleaginous base is cocoa butter. It is natural triglyceride, and among all fatty acids, it consists about 40% unsaturated fatty acids, and it can exist in more than one crystalline form or exhibits polymorphism. Now here, one important terminology, that is polymorphism, comes. So polymorphism is a phenomenon. It is a kind of phenomena which, due to which the molecules show this property, and they can convert into one crystalline form to another crystalline form, or from their crystalline form to amorphous form. And due to this transformation, due to this polymorphism, the ingredients, the molecules can show different physicochemical properties. And these polymorphic forms are differ from each other in terms of stability also. So that we will be discussing in next slide also. So it consists of, this cocoa butter consists of a mixture of ester of oleic acid, palmitic acid, stearic acid, and other fatty acids with glycerol. And its major source is fat, which is obtained from roasted seed of Theobroma cocoa. And thus, on the basis of its source, it is also known as Theobroma. So let us now discuss its few properties. Like at room temperature, it is yellowish, white solid, having a faint, agreeable, chocolate-like color. Chemically, it is a triglyceride, as we have discussed in previous slide, combination of glycerin and one or more different fatty acids, primarily oleopalmitostearin and oleodiesterin, and it melts at 30-35 degrees Celsius. So here are some advantages as well as disadvantages of this cocoa butter. So let us discuss them in brief. First of all, advantages is that it just melts below the body. Means its melting point is just below the body temperature. So from the initial introduction of the suppositories, we have already discussed that the suppositories are meant to be inserted into body cavities, and after their insertion, they should get melted and should release the medicament to produce its intended therapeutic response. So this cocoa butter will act as a base into which medicament will be added, and they will be molded into certain shapes, and then after administration at the body temperature, they will get melted spontaneously. So maintaining their solidity at usual room temperature is required. They can readily liquefy on heating and solidify on cooling. This is the major property of the cocoa butter. But it has certain disadvantages. The major disadvantages associated with cocoa butter is it exhibits marked polymorphism. As we were discussing it, the polymorphism, as I've already told, is a phenomena of conversion of one crystalline form to another crystalline form, or one crystalline to amorphous. So this polymorphism exhibits in cocoa butter while heating and cooling process. So for example, it exists in certain forms like beta and gamma theobroma oil or cocoa butter. So the one form is stable while the another form is unstable. So upon heating or during the molding process of the suppository, the cocoa butter may get converted into its unstable form, and thus this will exhibit instability. Another disadvantage is it is prone to rancidity. Rancidity is somewhat related to the oxidation of fatty acids. Rancidity indicates a kind of chemical instability of the any material. Rancidity is also related to a kind of foul smell which comes from the fatty materials. Like in our day-to-day life, we use butter at home. Makhan, in Hindi we say it, butter or makhan. The makhan is a kind of unsaturated fatty acids, and if we don't store that in proper storage conditions, means it is stable at refrigerated conditions, but at the high temperature, the butter gets rancid. It shows a foul odor, as well as taste is also modified, and color is also turned from white to yellowish. Similar kind of rancidity is exhibited by certain kinds of oily materials, including cocoa butter. Then, while formulating using a mold method, which we will be discussing in the formulation part, it sticks to the mold. It has a very high problem, very great problem of stickiness to the mold. And another disadvantage, that is leakage from body cavity. After inserting into the body cavities, it gets melted and it gets leaked from the body cavities, which results in patient incompliance. Another thing is it is costly as compared to other bases, which we will be discussing later on. Then it is miscible with body fluids, because the body fluids, the rectum fluids or the vaginal fluids, they are hydrophilic in nature. But this cocoa butter is highly lipophilic and it is immiscible with body fluids, and thus it may retard the drug release. And also it is incompatible with certain ingredients which can be added, or APIs which can be used for the rectal administration, like chloral hydrate or lactic acid. So in the presence of these components like lactic acid or chloral hydrate, the theobroma oil tends to get liquefied even at low temperature. Before inserting it in the body cavities, this suppository base into the suppository will get liquefied, so it will destabilize the formulation. Another base is emulsified theobroma oil or emulsified cocoa butter. It is similar to the cocoa butter, but it is available in a emulsified manner. Emulsified means it will be emulsified with some other oils. So it may be used as a base when large quantity of aqueous solutions are to be incorporated, like 5% glycerin, 10% latex, 5% cetyl alcohol, 4% beeswax. These are recommended for emulsified theobroma oil, from an emulsified theobroma oil base for the preparation of some. Then third is hydrogenated oils. They are a very much suitable substitute of theobroma oil. Their examples are hydrogenated edible oil, coconut oil, hydrogenated pea oil, stearic acid, or palm kernel oil. They are having certain advantages as compared to the previous theobroma oil, such as overheating the solidifying, like in that case, we have discussed the problem of polymorphism of theobroma oil. So in this, these oils, if we overheat them, so it will not affect their solidifying point. They are resistant to oxidation, means there is no problem of rancidity, which we have discussed in the case of theobroma oil. Then there in theobroma oil molds, theobroma oil suppositories, we have discussed that they stick to the mold. That is also one of the major drawbacks associated with the theobroma oil. So lubrication is the most required parameter in the case of theobroma oil based suppositories. But if we are using hydrogenated oils, these oils act as the lubricant, and thus lubrication of mold is not required. Their emulsifying and water absorbing capacity are also greater, or we can say good, as compared to previous ones. But though having these advantages, they are also associated with certain disadvantages, like when we will discuss the method of preparation. So that methods include fusion method, which we have already discussed, in ointment or creams or in paste. So in this also, the bases are melted and then they are cooled. But if the hydrogenated oil based suppository base, upon rapid cooling, they become brittle. Brittle means fragile, having not sufficient mechanical strength. So when another disadvantage, when melted, they are more fluid than pure palm oil and result in greater sedimentation of the added substances. Means their viscosity in the melted form is less than theobroma oil, which results in certain disadvantages of hydrogenated oils as compared to theobroma oils. Then another category of suppository base includes hydrophilic bases. Hydrophilic bases means, till we have discussed two bases which are more of category of hydrophobic or oleogenous bases. Now next category is hydrophilic bases. In this, first is water dispersible bases. These are the mixture of known ionic surfactants which are chemically related to the polyethylene glycol. The polyethylene glycol is the same material which we have discussed in the ointment bases. The in ointment we have discussed four categories. The fourth category was water soluble bases, and that is macroballs or polyethylene glycol. The same base, polyethylene glycol, can be used as a water dispersible base in case of suppositories also. So these are used alone or in combination with other type of bases, as similar to ointment case, we have discussed that in detail there. Cellulose derivatives like methyl cellulose, sodium carboxymethyl cellulose also come under this class. There are certain advantages and disadvantages of this water dispersible bases also. So like, if we talk about the advantages, they are suitable for both water soluble and oil soluble drugs, while the previous bases which we have discussed are more predominantly used for the oil soluble drugs. They do not support growth of the microbes in the preparation because they are hydrophilic in nature. They will not get rancid, they will not get oxidized, as well as they will not promote or support the growth of microorganisms. And they can be stored at elevated temperatures also. A major requirement in the initial suppository bases like theobroma oil or hydrogenated bases are, they has to be stored at the low temperature so that they can maintain their integrity, and after insertion into the body cavities they can get melted. But these kind of bases, if used once they are prepared, they can be stored at elevated temperatures. Their stability is quite more as compared to previous. But they are also associated with a disadvantage, that is their incompatibility or certain kind of interaction with few drugs, which can alter the therapeutic effect or bioavailability of drugs. The major examples of these water dispersible bases includes tweens, that is polyoxyethylene sorbitan fatty acid esters. Another is polyoxyethylene stearates, that is common name is Myris. Spans, which is a non-ionic surfactant. Tween is also a non-ionic surfactant. Spans are sorbitan fatty acid esters. They can be combination of different grades of tweens or spans, like 60% of tween 60 and 40% of tween 40, or so on, as per the particular requirement. Similarly, combination of tweens and glyceryl monostearates also preferred as a combination of water dispersible bases. Another class of water soluble bases is glycerogelatin base. This glycerogelatin base is also one of the most preferred bases nowadays as compared to theobroma oils, because theobroma oil or cocoa butter has very high limitations. But these glycerogelatin bases overcome most of the limitations associated with cocoa butter. Moreover, This glycerol editing base, I have told you already, this is required. This is almost used in the nasal suppositories. And they mainly act as the, occurs as the gel formulation. It is the mixture of gelatin, as name indicating, glycerogelatin. So it is composed of glycerine, that is glycerol, we can say that, or gelatin, and water. So according to British Pharmacopoeia, the composition of a common base, that is glycerine base, is composed of 14% of gelatin, 14% weight by weight of gelatin, 70% weight by weight glycerol, and remaining quantity of water in sufficient quantity required to make the volume up to 100 grams. Because we are talking in the terms of weight by weight. So for example, we have to formulate a base in a quantity of 100 grams, then 70 grams glycerine would be used, 14 grams of gelatin would be used, and remaining 16 grams of water would be added. And the 14 grams of water will be added, and to make the total quantity up to 100 grams. Even for getting a more stiffer mass, the quantity of gelatin can be increased to 32.5%, and the glycerol quantity can be reduced to 40%. This is according to the compendial specifications. So, we can correlate like gelatin is responsible for the stiffness of the formulation, suppository formulation, and glycerol would be responsible for the less viscosity of the formulation. Then other hydrophilic bases, the properties of hydrophilic bases includes, it is colorless, transparent, translucent in nature, soft to touch, and they can exist, gelatin bases can exist in two types, type A or pharmagel A, which indicates its acidic nature and it is used for acidic drugs, while pharmagel B, it is alkaline in nature and used for basic drugs, and in vaginal suppositories or pessaries, we can say. So these glycerogelatin bases are mostly preferred. They melt at body temperature. They mix with body fluids, no rancidity. It can be compatible with major of the ingredients which are used for the suppositories like boric acid, chloral hydrate, bromides, iodides, and thus they are includes their advantages. But a few disadvantages are also there, like they are difficult to prepare and handle. There is chances of bacterial growth. They are hygroscopic in nature, like they become hard on drying and soft in contact with moisture. Hygroscopic means, the word hygroscopic indicates the property of a molecule, means absorption of water from the atmosphere. Moreover, it is laxative in action and may be incompatible with certain molecules like tannic acid and gallic acid. Now, other advantages of these polyethylene glycols or macrobols, which is also a part of these hydrophilic bases, apart from gelatin bases, they are also chemically stable, non-irritant, inert, do not allow bacterial growth. Physical properties changes according to their molecular weight. They provide prolonged action. They do not stick to the mold, and suppositories which are formulated by using such type of hydrophilic bases would be clean and smooth in appearance. This macrobols or polyethylene glycols have certain disadvantages also, like hygroscopic in nature, as I've already told of in the case of gelatoglycerin base also, incompatible with some drugs like amines or phenols, and in some cases super saturation may take place. Then third category of bases include emulsifying or synthetic bases. So let us first discuss the advantages of these emulsifying bases, and then we will discuss different types of emulsifying bases. So they solidify rapidly. The emulsifying bases has a property of solidification rapidly, non-irritant, as similar to the hydrophilic bases, the lubrication of mold is not required, while in the Theobroma oil, the lubrication is a major problem. Overheating does not affect the physical properties of the base. They can absorb fairly a large amount of water or aqueous liquids. The white, odorless, clean and attractive suppositories are produced using such kind of bases, and also they are very less liable to or susceptible to get rancid. The rancidity or the oxidation chemical instabilities are very much less in the case of synthetic or emulsifying bases. The disadvantage is, like, they should not be cooled rapidly in a refrigerator because they become brittle. We have also discussed this point in initial basis also. And they are not very viscous on melting. Their viscosity is less. So the medicaments which are incorporated into the base may get settled down separation, which results in non-uniform or non-homogeneous suppositories. So different kinds of emulsifying bases according to BP in European countries, the different emulsifying bases which are used includes Vitepsol. Vitepsol consists of triglycerides of saturated vegetable fatty acids with varying percentage of partial esters, means the fatty acids are reacted with some kind of vegetable fatty alcohols and they are formulated as an esters. A small amount of beeswax is also added to the Vitepsol. It is the property which is associated with Vitepsol that it should not be cooled rapidly, because on rapid cooling, when we will be discussing the method of preparation of suppository, the same fusion method is followed. So when we melt the base and then after to get the mold, get it mold in a particular shape, it is cooled. But upon rapid cooling, it becomes brittle and get fractured. In this case, lubrication is required. Next is Mesa Asterinum emulsifying base. It is a mixture of mono, di, and triglycerides of saturated fatty acids, having the molecular chain ranging from 11 carbon to 17 carbons, means C11 to C17 chain. Another name of this Mesa Asterinum is Adipus solidus. This is a Latin name, and it is appearance is white, brittle, almost odorless, tasteless solid, and it has a melting point of approximately 33 to 36 degrees Celsius, as similar to the Theobroma oil. They are also available in various grades like grade A, B, C, but the grade B is commonly used in dispensing. The last emulsifying base is Mesupol. It consists of glyceryl esters, mainly of lauric acid, to which small amount of glyceryl monostearate has been added to improve its water absorbing capacity. Another base which is generally used is soap glycerin base. This is as similar to the glycerogelatin base. In this case, gelatin and crude soap or sodium stearate, which makes the glycerin sufficiently hard for suppositories, and a large quantity up to 95% of glycerin can be incorporated into it. Further, the soap helps in evacuation of glycerin after administration. The soap glycerin base has the major disadvantage that it is very hygroscopic in nature. Therefore, its suppositories must be protected from atmosphere and should be wrapped in some foil or waxed paper. Means it require a particular sophisticated type of packaging. Otherwise, it may get melted or get softened at the during the storage before administration. Now, after discussing these bases, next is the method of preparation. So there are mainly four methods of preparation, like hand rolling, machine molding, fusion method, and cold compression. So now let us discuss these methods in brief, one by one. So first one is hand rolling. So as you are able to view in this slide, hand rolling method, it is the oldest and simplest method of suppository preparation. In this, the base of suppository is mixed with the medicament and rolled by hand. Like we make chapatis, we roll as chapatis, and the thick round shaped suppositories are then converted into the pre-required size formulations. And this may be used only when a few suppositories, means in a lab laboratory scale, these method can be used to, and mainly cocoa butter is used as a base. It has an advantage of avoiding the necessity of heating the cocoa butter. As we have already discussed, there is a problem of associated with heating the cocoa butter, as it may convert into its polymorphic forms, unstable polymorphic forms. Thus, if we are using this hand rolling method, the need of heating the cocoa butter can be bypassed. A plastic like mass is prepared by triturating grated cocoa butter and active ingredient in a mortar. The mass is formed into a ball in the palm of the hands and then rolled into a uniform cylinder with a large spatula or small flat board on a pill tile. The cylinder is then cut into the appropriate number of pieces, which are rolled on one end to produce a conical shape, or as the shape which is required for the insertion into the body cavities. Effective hand rolling requires considerable practice and skill. The suppository pipe or cylinder tends to crack or hollow in the center, especially when the mass is insufficiently kneaded and softened. Next method is the machine molding, in which instead of hand, we are using some machines. But in machine moldings or molds, the major issue associates with the lubricants. So like in cocoa butter or emulsion bases, there is a requirement of lubrication of the molds. This lubrication is required to prevent the sticking of the suppository to the wall of the mold's cavity. It is also useful in easy removal of suppository from the molds. The lubricants they form a film between the wall of mold cavity and base of the suppository, so it prevent adhering of the bases to the molds. And the nature of the lubricant can be varied from as per the nature of the base. Generally, soap spirit and liquid paraffin can be used as the lubricant, and synthetic fats and macrogols bases do not require lubricants. They, as we have already discussed, in the case of macrogols or synthetic fats, there is no requirement of lubricant because they act as the self-lubricating agent. The third method is the fusion method. This fusion method is as similar to the method which we have discussed in the formulation of other semi-solid dosage forms like ointment or creams or paste. In this, the base is taken, the suppository base as per our requirement can be taken. It can be melted into the some glass apparatus according to the melting point, at a temperature according to its melting point. Overheating should not be done. Then the medicament, single medicament or a mixture of medicaments, can be dissolved or dispersed in the molten base. The mixture is removed from the heat and poured into the suppository mold, and that melted molten mass is allowed to congeal to reduce its temperature. Then from the mold, the suppositories can be removed. The fusion method can be used with all type of suppositories which we have discussed, and must be used with most of the bases. Small scale molds are capable of producing 6 or 12 suppositories in a single operation, while industrial molds produce as many as hundreds of suppositories from a single molding. So this is the diagrammatic representation of the molds, where you are able to view the molds has two parts. In closed condition, they create the cavity into which the molten mass having the dispersed drug can be added, and the congealing process can be initiated by putting the mold into the refrigerator. And after getting the proper consistency, proper shape, the two parts of the suppository mold can be separated using the side screws, and the molded suppositories can be obtained, cut into the required shape, and can be further packed. The fusion method, next method is the compressing molding. Compression molding is a method of preparing suppositories from a mixed mass of grated suppository base and medicaments, which is forced into a special compression mold using suppository making machines. This kind of compression molding is similar to the tablet punching. So now you have not discussed till now, you have not, I think, studied about the tablet formulation. So just you can imagine a kind of machine into which the grated suppository base, without getting melted or fused, the mixed mass, grated mass, can be put into a die, a cavity, onto which some compression force can be applied so that the components get the required shape as per the requirement. The suppository base and the other ingredients can be combined through mixing. The friction of process causing the base to soften into a paste like consistency. This is a typical example of the compression molding machine, which consists of one piston cylinder having the prepared mass in its cavity, and the piston is allowed to compress the prepared mass, and thus which results in the compression of the suppositories. Then after this, some other ingredients or excipients which are added into the suppository apart from API and base are, the most important one is antioxidants. It protects the drugs and bases also from getting degraded due to oxidation. The oxidation is a chemical property, chemical instability, which results in the rancidity of the bases, which we have discussed in theobroma oil or emulsifying bases, and they are commonly used in all type of suppositories. The common examples of antioxidants which are used include ethyl or propyl gallate, ascorbic acid, butylated hydroxy anisole, that is BHA, butylated hydroxy toluene, that is BHT, hydroquinone, or tocopherols. Another excipients like emulsifying agents can be added. They increase the water absorbing capacity of the fatty bases, and the examples of emulsifying agents which are used in formulation of suppositories include polysorbates like tweens, wool alcohol, or wool fats. Hardening agents which are added into the suppositories includes beeswax or macrogols of high molecular weight. Macrogols are PEGs, as we have discussed earlier. They exist in different molecular weights, like the less molecular weight macrogols 200, PEG 400, 600, they exist in the liquid form. Okay, while as their molecular weight approaches a higher value like PEG 1000 or more than it, it appears it exists in the solid waxy form. So the macrogols which are having high molecular weight and exist as the solid waxy material, they can be added into the formulated bases to impart the hardness to the suppositories. It is added in the formulation where the melting point of the bases can be decreased by the addition of drugs. Means there are some chances in which there are incompatibility or a kind of physical incompatibility between drug and bases, in which the drug leads to liquefaction of the bases. In that case, to increase the hardness of that suppository base, these macrogols can be added. Next important excipient is preservative. because these suppository base, some of the bases are of the natural origin, like cocoa butter, or emulsion bases consist of fatty acids which are prone to the growth of microbial contamination. So these are the agents which are used in prevention of the growth of microbial contamination in suppositories. Examples are chlorocresol, methyl paraben, or propyl parabens. Apart from it, another important excipient is thickening agent. These are the agents which are used to increase the viscosity. As the name is indicating, thickening means they have to increase the thickness, or we can say that viscosity of the base, molten bases, and prevent the sedimentation of suspended material. As we have discussed in the glycerogelatin base or other water soluble bases, the major disadvantage associated with those bases is when we melt those bases, the viscosity is very less, means they are kind of liquid, very less viscous. And then when we disperse the solid medicament into it, there are wide chances that the medicament can get settled down. This problem we have discussed in the while we were discussing the hydrophilic bases. So to prevent that kind of problem and to increase the viscosity, if we will increase the viscosity of the base, then this sedimentation problem will get overcome and we will get a suppositories of means having the drug distributed into them in a uniform manner. So thickening agents are used to increase the viscosity of molten bases and prevent sedimentation of suspended solid bases. And the common examples of thickening agents are aluminium monostearate, colloidal silica, magnesium stearate, or stearyl alcohol. The last excipient, apart from these which we have discussed, is plasticizer. So plasticizers are the agents which are used to improve the flexibility of the suppositories, and they are added into the suppository bases, obviously to the glycerogelatin base or other hydrophilic bases which are prone to brittleness. We have also discussed this disadvantage of the hydrophilic bases, that they are fragile, or we can say that they are brittle. If we cool them very rapidly, so this brittleness problem initiates in the suppositories. Now, to overcome this problem, a certain kind of plasticizers can be added, which will improve the flexibility and will reduce the brittle property of the suppositories. Certain examples of plasticizer includes castor oils, glycerin, glycols, tween 80 or tween 85. Now, I'm stopping this session of suppositories here only. So in later session, we will be discussing another important aspect of suppositories, that is displacement value and evaluation of suppositories. Now, with this, I welcome the next speaker of the session, Mr. Rohit Bhatia, who will be discussing with you the aspects of chemistry. So over to Mr. Rohit Bhatia. Thank you all for your patience listening.